Welcome everyone to the video. We give thanks to the Holy Spirit for clarifying what our problem is and what the solution is. I'm actually a little bit alarmed at, right now. I did say that after President's Day, that is when the beatdown is going to begin. I was told this several months ago, given a time frame, and I was told, you better be ready. You better be very clear and have a breakthrough by that time. So I did succeed at that. But I don't follow the news. I don't look at anything. I don't know what's going on in the world. A chance comment by an acquaintance today who started mentioning about some situation in the Ukraine, and I don't know anything about it. So I just happened to look, and it just so happens that after President's Day, Monday was, I believe, the 17th, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, this time frame, there's been an extreme problem in the Ukraine developing, and pretty amazing timing. If you look at the history of the Ukraine, it's just unbelievable what's happened there. Tired of all this stuff, right? Very, very tired of the world's act at this point. Don't want to pay any more attention to this nonsense. Now, the situation here is that the Holy Spirit has convinced me that its teachings are correct. Its teachings are correct. Our goal, the way to salvation, is to exchange our perception, which means the perception coming from a particular location. Sensory perception coming from a particular location, like this body, the eyes, ears, the sensory perception of a particular body, to exchange that for the perception of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit actually has a perception for us. It shares its perception for us. And that perception is a spiritual perception, and it is different type of perception. It's not based on a particular location, looking out from that location. It's a type of perception that seems to have its center everywhere. And therefore, everything is near and dear to it. There's no such thing as something that's distant from it in terms of what we would feel as identity. So what happens with this perception is you have this one shared identity because of this perception. Everything is equally near and dear to this perception. So you have this sense of there's just one identity. Okay. This resolves the continuity problem that we have. And a continuity problem, again, is the extreme dread we have of a very serious, abrupt, and drastic change in our experiencing. And then that's permanent. And we're just terrified of that. So this Holy Spirit's perception of this one shared identity, of everything, having a one shared identity called the vision of oneness, this reminds us of reality so powerfully, so clearly, that we're willing to actually give up perception and eventually drop perception altogether for direct knowing, which is what reality really is. But again, that step is not our goal. Our goal is the vision of oneness. So by President's Day, I was able to get this clarity and sense that the Holy Spirit was telling us truly about this, that we are being guided correctly from just a very objective, very reasonable, assessment of the whole situation. Who's telling the truth? Is it the ego or the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit's telling the truth. Jesus has been telling us the truth. And this is how we are saved. This is the only way we're saved. The Holy Spirit has a perception of everything. It shares this perception with us. We no longer are reliant upon the physical, our physical perception for establishing identity. Of course, we can still use it to drive a vehicle. That's not the issue. The issue is identity. Okay? The issue is identity. Our sensory perception, what is made from projection and belief. Projection makes perception, makes belief, and it's all one constellation. And it, what happens is we believe that stuff farther away from us has less identity than stuff closer to us. All right, and so we feel that the center of perception here has identity, and everything else out there is other. And the further away it is from us, the more other it is. Okay, and it leaves us with a sense of conflict. Like there, out there is not my not identity. It's not identity. It's something trying to take my identity away. It's like an abyss out there. It's the problem of projection. All of this has been explained clearly to me over many, many years. Vision of oneness. I had some glimpses of it. It's there. I trust the Holy Spirit. It's there. This experience of one shared identity. I got a glimpse of it, several glimpses of it over the last week and a half. And it's legitimate. It's legit. This is the way to salvation. Now, is the world pursuing this objective, is the question. In all its attempts for peace, the world has been trying to broker peace forever. I'm so tired of it. I don't want to sit around anymore and watch all this conflict and turmoil and beat down continue to take place, knowing that it is just a farce. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. So in terms of trying to help people out at this, you know, at this level, burying the dead, as it were, let those who have this death-based belief system, which is really projection, perception, and belief, it's a death-based belief system, death-based situation, let them cope with what happens, what's going on in this world. Those who know the way to salvation, let them then go that way. I don't have any more stomach for world turmoil, world beatdown. No. I've had it. I've had it with that stuff. There's no intelligence in there. There's no awareness. If you look at the leaders of the world, all the media, everything, there is zero awareness of what salvation is. None. So you cannot help but continue on with the dynamics of projection. You cannot help, and you cannot help but have these ridiculous solutions continuously push this way and push that way with conflicts, etc., etc., etc. It's like a soap opera that you just don't want to watch anymore. Turn off the television set, really. Do something else. So I was told at the beginning of the time, the beatdown, the real action that is coming in this world would start right after President's Day. Well, then we had this, you know, initial severe skirmish in the Ukraine, which looks like it could degenerate into a civil war at this point, which would pit, you know, basically socialism against capitalism again, because the western part of the Ukraine wants to adopt the market strategies of the European Union, and whereas the eastern part wants to align more closely with the Russia and the socialist practices, etc., etc. And you know, here we go again, and it's really too much. Why should we subject ourselves to this? It's kind of like, you know, two people, juveniles, who just love to get bicker and argue and get in fights, and they just keep doing it, and they don't listen to a thing you say. So at some point you just have to say, forget it. I'm not really interested in this. Why should we be bound? Why should our attention be bound by this? It doesn't seem right. The news is useless. It doesn't give a solution. What good is it to continually pay attention to what gives absolutely no solution, but just hits you with this continual carnage, you know? Well, what use is that? It's very dispiriting. The underlying dynamics of the situation have not been looked at, period, in the world. All this talk of how advanced we are is nonsense. And it will continue to be nonsense until people realize it is nonsense. This secular, materialistic utopia that we're pursuing leaves the underlying dynamics totally untouched, totally unexamined. And the whole purpose is to leave them perpetually unexamined. Is to just say, look, we're so happy with our materiality, we're not going to look at what the underlying troubles might be. It's just a whitewash of the whole thing. And so there's no possibility of real peace happening. Real peace is to experience the shared identity of everything. And then there's no possibility of conflict or war at all. What we're trying to do is force a peace upon a conflicted inner dynamic. And then people turn to alcoholism and drugs things, etc., and it just collapses over and over. Just read the history of the Ukraine. It is the most demoralizing, dispiriting thing. You know, it's just like, it's the history of the world. Constant battles and wars and taking over and split and political intrigue, and it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And here we go again. Ukraine has been through so much. The terrible, you know, famines and political migrations, forced deportations, and I mean, World War II actually started over the Ukraine, actually, because Catherine the Great wanted Germans to immigrate to the Ukraine, and many, many did. There's a huge German farming population in the Ukraine, and then the Germans said, "Hey, look, we want to have the Ukraine as part of Germany. We need more living space," and so they invaded Russia, went to the Ukraine. That was their real objective, was living space. They wanted more territory. And they felt the Germans there were not being treated properly, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a tinderbox, the Ukraine. It's a tinderbox. And you know, I've had enough of this idiotic world, which is nothing but a play of projection. This play of projection is no longer want to frequent that. Serves no purpose whatsoever. It's meaningless, totally meaningless. So, you know, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? What do we do? Is the question. I'd like to find an answer to that. If you know the truth, okay, then this idiocy has no interest. It totally has no interest whatsoever. You know, carnage has no interest. There's no interest in it. I had a dream also where the storm clouds were gathering, and suddenly it started raining, and heavy rain. And that was that dream was I think it was last Tuesday night or last Monday night, just after President's Day. And then now this thing in the Ukraine happened at that exact same time. And in the dream I said, oh my gosh, here comes the storm. There's a bigger storm behind this. This is just a squall. Okay, what's happening in the Ukraine is just a squall. It's an outbreak. Behind it is this massive storm. And this is just, you know, just the beginning of some raindrops, but the raindrops are heavy. What I found was that heavy rain is coming. And what I saw was there's this huge palm tree, this beautiful palm tree that spread out in the canopy. And I said, hey, let's get underneath this palm tree. There's no rain falling there whatsoever. And so I'm very serious about that, this. And so focusing my, you know, will and attention there. I've always said relocation may happen here. It may happen. It may be a dimensional relocation. It may be. It's very possible. I don't know. But I would say something has to happen, because you're wasting your time when you're trying to quote-unquote help these people. Another thing I've been indicated to me is that what's been indicated to me is the situation in the world is so chaotic and in such a terrible crisis that I've been told, get out of the way. Get out of the way. Don't you try and help it. You're not capable of it. Let the real pros handle this situation. Now, my recent work has involved me in something that I'm no good at, and there's some real professionals dealing with what the work entails, which is really construction. And a lot of times they might need help to lift something really heavy or deal with some dangerous situation, and I don't know what's going on really. And so they just say, hey, get out of the way. You know, you're just going to cause problems if you get in there and try to help, because they know exactly what you have to do. Step one, step two, step three, the dangers, everything's shifting here. They need to change positions here. You know, it's a dangerous thing. And they're pros, they're professionals. They've done it before many times. And they know all the dangers and how to react to them, etc. But if you're in there, just don't know what you're doing, and you're trying to help out of goodwill, let me just help, put a show of help, you actually get in the way. You actually get in the way. So I've had to learn, swallow my pride and say, there are times when you just have to be a bystander and get out of the way, which I have done. I've learned to do that. I just say, okay, guys, you know, you know what you're doing. It's hard. It's hard because you feel like you're useless. But I think the people doing the work appreciate that. Just get out of the way. They let the pros handle the pros' business. And if you're not a pro, and it's a dangerous situation, just get out of the way, because you'll make it more difficult for them. So what's been indicated to me is that there's those of us in the world who are, you know, who are getting close to the vision of oneness. We're not pros at all. There are enlightened beings that let them, they're the pros, let them handle this situation in the world. Let them handle it. And the rest of us just get out of the way. Get out of their way. Get out of their way. This situation that's coming up in the world, you've got to be a pro's pro to know how to deal with this situation, for sure. For sure. This is not just this world. This is a cosmic projection at work here. This is a big, big projection mess. And you've got to be perfectly clear, totally established in oneness, without a slightest doubt about it, and very familiar with all of that, and how to deal with these situations, and what the right moves are. And you just have to, I mean, this, whatever help comes to this world has to come from those who really know what they're doing. And I certainly don't know what I'm doing in that way. No way. Amateur. So the best thing to do is to get out of the way. Get out of their way, because if you're in there trying to help, then they have to try to protect you and help you, and you're struggling and stuff, and they can't do their job, that kind of thing. It's not right. It's not fair to them. It's not fair to those who really, you know what they're doing, to try and deal with people who are bumbling and fumbling on their team. You can't have those people. So it's better to get out of the way, accept the vision of oneness, get totally stable in that vision of oneness, and then at some point we'll be able to help out in some capacity. But I can tell you that there are those who have, you know, great capacity, pros, and we're not those. We're not those. I'm not one of those, for sure. I just have I'm getting it, but not there yet at all. So it's been indicated to me that there will be a sidestepping of the situation. And you have to be humble enough, swallow our pride, and say, we're not good enough to deal with this. This is an intense situation that's coming in the world. I've seen it close up. The amount of indoctrination that people have willingly subjected themselves to is truly incredible. By watching television, for instance. All right, that's one of the main ways. It's a total indoctrination that's taking place in the world, but to subject oneself to such an incredible amount of misdirection, of projection. People are incredibly addicted to projection and incredibly into it right now. Very much into it. And that's a real dangerous thing, actually. Dangerous to those who are trying to get free of projection in that regard. It's not dangerous to the Holy Spirit, but as far as our will and resolve to get free of projection, exchange perception for the vision of the Holy Spirit, it's a very dangerous thing. And people have literally become super, super hardcore projectionists, super loyal, very, very, very brainwashed into that, indoctrinated into that, very much familiar with it. They have a super comfort zone with hardcore projection. Projection leads to attack. So they actually have a super, super great comfort zone with projection and attack here in this world. And, you know, how to deal with that? We're out of our league when it comes to that right now, because we still have a tendency to, you know, crumble when the pressure gets too severe. Absolutely. I have a hard time around people just keeping my practice going. It just tends to kind of dissolve away. It's very difficult. I'm trying. When I'm by myself, I can do it. But then around other people, oh man, it's very tough. So when you get the whole world coming at you, all these hardcore projectionists, you know, likely you just get very confused and depressed. So I expect something to break very soon here, as far as some kind of refuge. I've seen that. Now what that palm tree represents, I don't know. But usually it represents an oasis, doesn't it? In a desert, in a scorching hot desert. You got this beautiful, lush, cool oasis. That's what it really represents. And the umbrella of the palm tree keeps all the scorching heat, the torrential rain, keeps everything off there and keeps this cool microclimate, beautiful, perfect microclimate under the palm tree. So it's like an oasis, I would say, a refuge, an asylum. So seeking asylum from this world actually is a very, very smart thing to do. And when we get a glimpse of the Holy Spirit's vision of oneness, we realize that there's no such thing as anything that's distant to the Holy Spirit. Anywhere. The distance, there's nothing that is distant from the Holy Spirit. Nothing. Nowhere. Nowhere is distant. The everywhereness is everywhere. And the Holy Spirit's vision is everywhere. It comes from everywhere. It is centered everywhere. So there's no such thing as distant. So it's not inconceivable that asylum, refuge could take place from this planet. And it's not a distant concept. You see what I'm saying? To the Holy Spirit, it's no such thing as distance. It has the capacity to we can think in terms of take refuge from this world when it comes to the Holy Spirit. Because when it comes to projection, we only think of taking refuge of going someplace in this world or someplace nearby. Let's go hide in this house, or let's head for the mountains or something like that. But we don't think in terms of let's take refuge from this world, from this planet. Which is really a planet of hardcore projectionists here. You just look at it. The history of this planet is so appalling that I can't even look at it. It's too appalling. It's absolute madness. It's severe, severe projection. Severe fear, severe entrenchment in the body's perception and all the attendant exacerbation of projection that that brings about. When we accept the body's perception as our identity, as it were, that only makes projection worse. Worse. I remember when I was young, I did not accept the body's senses as primary. I was able to see spiritually, and there's a big battle here, telling me I needed to identify primarily with the body senses, and I resisted that for a long time. And then once you do, it leads to projection, anxiety, alienation, conflict, every single misery, every single misery. So I would say there's going to be something coming up very soon. Very soon. The world has not demonstrated a mood to listen to those of wisdom. At all. In fact, it seems to be dwindling. The problem, the mirage of this world is the mirage of youth. So many people are under, 33 or something, more than half the world, or some incredible statistic of the world is there's so many young people here in the world. And this gives a mirage of open-mindedness, and some sort of feeling that youth is optimism and hope. And we've misinterpreted that to think that the world is getting better just because of so many young people. This is ludicrous. Ludicrous. Having been through it all myself, and all of us have youth, we can, recognize and say, no, that is not wisdom. Youth thinks that it can solve all problems. It also feels that they're bulletproof. The youth, nothing can touch them. They got the answer, right? You know how that is, that you go through a phase, we got relatives go through that phase, and they know better than their parents. They know the answer. They're going to solve the problems, okay? Why? Just because they have so much energy, they say, whatever the problem is, I can tackle it and I'm going to defeat it. But they don't have a clue what the problem is, actually. So how are they going to defeat the problem? They're not looking at the problem at all. They don't even know what it is. They're attacking the wrong problem. So all the energy in the world of youth applied to the wrong problem is not going to solve anything. Just make it worse. And I know when I tried to educate my contemporaries when I was younger, didn't get anywhere. Not really. There's only a few people that really tuned into it. Just like now, there are a few people around the planet that are tuning in the truth, and there are a few people here that get it, Obviously, there's some here that get it. But the majority you trying to teach this, you says, well, whatever you say, I'm sure I got the energy, I can stay up all night for the next 3 years and I'll be able to understand it, I can get it, I can do anything. That's folly. Don't be misled by that folly. I remember when young, you look at a mountain range and says, I can climb that today. I'll climb in a couple hours. I did that. There's just like this sterile steep mountain. I said, I'm just going to go climb up. I went climb, just ran, just climb real fast, running up this mountain, got to the top, and then found some wooden pole, and then ran down, kind of vaulting on this pole down the whole mountainside. It was absolutely crazy. That's the kind of energy you're thinking, I can surmount any obstacle. Just give me the challenge, I can do it easily. It's not that easy when it comes to this situation at all. It requires totally different mindset, the mood of repentance. It requires the mood of repentance. Very sober, very calm, very patient, very difficult and tough. It's only those who are truly, absolutely fed up with projection who apply the right kind of effort to this, where the enthusiasm of youth is used up very quickly. And then it's just absolute willful determination and all-out struggle to try and break out of the chains of projection, perception, and belief. So the world really thinks that it's getting it, but that's just the enthusiasm and optimism of youth that is permeating the planet at this time. And those of us who are wise enough can see right through that. We're not deceived by that. And the youth, you know, feel, you don't need to sidestep this stuff. We'll solve the problems. We'll get it solved. Youth always feels that way. Every generation feels that they have the answer. They're going to get it done. It's the history of the planet. And to the older people who say, no, you're not going to get it done that way, they say, you're just old and washed up. You just don't have the energy. You know, you're just a sour grapes loser, that kind of thing. Well, let them have their attitude that way. That is fine. If they want to say that about me, about you, about anyone else, let them say that. Fine. We'll see who is smiling later on. I can assure you that the vision of oneness will leave you in a state of bliss. This total, perfect, shared, one identity. The feeling is just, you know, indescribable in terms of, not in terms of simply richness, the richness of it. Just the blissful. I just got the tiniest little, you know, look into it. I was able to sort of look and I said, oh, wow. That's it. That's what we really want. That's what we really want. We don't need to solve any problems of the world. We merely need to have this perception of the one shared identity. And that instantly, no more problems. At least, you know, for us. Because of the instant peace. In the Holy Spirit, there's no conflict. In the vision and the perception of the Holy Spirit, there's no projection, there's no alienation, there's no depression, there's none of that stuff, there's no conflict. It is just a smoothed out smoothness. Nothing but that incredibly smoothed out smoothness and blessedness of everything, equal, all one shared identity. No such thing as anything distanced in any way. Location doesn't have the slightest effect on it whatsoever. There's no such thing as location-based identity. So I'm kind of getting alerted here that something's going to likely to transpire in some way, some breakthrough in terms of what do we do during this now, this upcoming time in the world. What do those do who really have no more interest in paying attention to the world? Because we think that by paying attention, we're going to learn something about our identity. We're not going to learn anything about our identity by paying attention to this world. We will learn absolutely nothing about reality and our true identity by paying attention to the events of this world. Absolutely nothing. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. We only are reminded of our true identity and reality by the vision of oneness. That's the only way. The only way we get truly reminded. Anything else is completely worthless, waste of time. So paying attention to the world and the world events, etc., is totally useless. Totally useless. Complete meaningless waste of time. And the problem is that the turmoil of this world is going to get so severe that, you know, it's such a pain ignoring it all while you're living here. It really is really a big pain. I mean, I'd imagine it's possible. I've tried to my life, but people keep pushing it on you. And you feel, you know, you don't want to feel too completely out of touch with your neighbors and your peer groups and all this stuff. And if you're in a peer group, etc., and you have no idea what's going on in the world and could absolutely care less, you're going to feel very isolated and ostracized probably. So there's got to be some accommodations for those of us who realize there's absolutely no purpose to it all whatsoever to paying attention to what's going on here. None. We learn nothing about our identity or our true home by paying attention to this world? Nothing. In fact, way worse than that. We go into greater and greater states of forgetfulness. The more we pay attention to this world, the more severe our forgetfulness becomes. So let those whose goal is to become completely forgetful of reality, let them deal with the misery and troubles that brings about. So at least maybe that'll help them get sick and tired of it more quickly. If you keep cleaning up the messes that they make, they keep thinking, hey, well, this ain't that bad, you know, no, let them clean up the messes. Let them deal with it. And then they may feel, you know, hey, I don't want to keep doing this. This is terrible. I thought I could get someone to clean up the mess. Maybe God would clean up the mess for me or something. And now I have to deal with this mess. Oh, you know, forget it. Hopefully that will, you know, usually the only thing that turns people around is suffering. That's in my case, suffering, 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 suffering. And you just say, I don't want this. Forget it. Now, they may turn against God if we don't clean up their mess. That's okay. It's okay. But the Holy Spirit knows how to guide them to reason and the vision of oneness. The Holy Spirit can guide them. Even if they're angry at God or angry at Spirit or whatever. Still, the Holy Spirit knows how to use leverage and say, look, forget about all that stuff. Just focus on your suffering. You don't want it anymore. Here's the answer. You have a continuity problem. The vision of oneness cures the continuity problem. That's all. That's all you need. And it's not sectarian. It doesn't have to be religious or any of this stuff. It's just pragmatic. It's pure pragmatism. And people can respond to pure pragmatism. Even though they maybe have all sorts of resentments and bitterness, you know, of like, why did I, how come I wasn't helped, and how come all this kind of stuff. I mean, I feel that way. Why has my life been so difficult? How come I wasn't helped more? Well, I mean, the Holy Spirit was probably blocking everything so I wouldn't get off track somehow. And it was very, very frustrating for sure. But it knows its goal. It knows the goal, which is to bring you to the vision of oneness. It knows its goal. It knows how to bring us to that goal, no matter what our, you know, what our failures and struggles and suffering has been. So we might even get hate God and just be so angry at God. Say, God, you're trying to destroy me and all this stuff. And the Holy Spirit will help you see, look, that isn't true, but you got a continuity problem. So the vision of, you don't go straight back to God reconciliation. You take the intermediate step, which is the reconciliation step of reconciliation, actually. And perceive the shared identity, vision of oneness, and that will resolve then all your anger and bitterness towards God, which all came from projection. And we can get it. We can get that. So, if the Holy Spirit says, back off, sidestep it, then, you know, you got to realize that it's telling you, giving you the right advice. Stay out of the way. Let the pros handle the situation. Let those who are, if the Holy Spirit has a team to help out here, let that team operate the way it needs to operate, you know, because they may be, you know, be able to allow all sorts of stuff to happen that we would just be horrified by, you know, like, oh, you got to step in and stop that. You got to stop that. You know, it's like whenever I see something, a problem in the world, I always want to jump in and help out. But I've seen that actually that often makes things worse. It has unintended consequences, actually, that we don't really see the total picture at all, what's going on. And this is very important. We don't see the total picture. We can make things much, much worse by helping out in certain ways, thinking that this is, I just want to help out and make things worse, slow things down for the Holy Spirit. So we really, if the Holy Spirit says, look, back off, We should back off. We should sidestep it. Take a break. Take refuge. Say, okay. And maybe we're afraid the Holy Spirit will withhold the vision of oneness. No, it won't. And I can say that because the Holy Spirit has clarified for me very clearly what it's all about. So it hasn't withheld clarity from me at all. I am quite sure that this clarity is going to lead the vision of oneness. I don't feel the Holy Spirit trying to hold anything back in the world. I'm not experiencing, I don't feel any, you know, retribution from the Holy Spirit for that attitude at all. No, absolutely not. If you're willing to accept the vision of oneness, you will get the vision of oneness. If you prepare for it, you will receive it. Knock and the door shall be opened, for sure. So these exercises are like knocking, and the door was opened several times. I said, oh my gosh, the door just opened. The door to the vision of oneness just opened up. And I looked in, I looked through the door. I looked in the opening of the door. I said, oh wow, what is this? Wow, that's amazing. How we have this, all this shared, suddenly we all have this one shared identity. I'm seeing it, I'm feeling it. It's amazing. It's the perception of the Holy Spirit. It's how the Holy Spirit sees. But our projections, everything that we see are simply our projections. But the Holy Spirit has a way to interpret our projections. That's its perception, that has this shared, total shared identity. Everything. There's just this one shared identity that we're feeling. Not just people, everything. It's all completely sacred. So, it's not something we have to earn. It's something that's given to us freely. And it's given to us based on our clarity and preparation. So if you prepare, you've prepared, that's it. If you're clear about it, you're clear about it. Nothing else matters. And ultimately, though, you know, if you say, well, I'm not going to help do anything other than just accept this vision, the Holy Spirit, I'm sure, will say, that's perfect. I don't think there's any pressure to do anything. In fact, I think there's pressure to take asylum away from those who are oriented in the opposite direction. Oriented away, you know, what the world wants to do is it wants to build up this identity based on all the people of the world agreeing with one another, of doing the same thing and saying, yeah, okay, this is the type of governance we should have, this is the type of leader we should have, this is the type of society we should have, all this kind of stuff. That's got nothing to do with salvation, just the opposite, because you're still using human physical sensory perception, which is based on projection and a belief system, a delusional projectional belief system, and it actually cannot help but bring about even worse projection. It cannot help but do it. Absolutely. You will feel a distancing, a sense of gradation, a sense of hierarchy, a sense of levels from the distancing from your perception. It inevitably seeps into you, absolutely inevitably. And then you'll believe that there are those who are better and those who are worse. Judgment. You will inevitably, judgment comes from perception, which comes from projection. Judgment. You will judge. And so the idea of like punishing the ones whose judgment we don't like and loving the judgment of those we do like, that's the wrong way. That's the ego's way. Holy Spirit says, judge not, lest you be judged, right? Get out of that whole matrix of perception, judgment, and accept the vision of oneness. That's the only route to salvation. So it's a bureaucratic solution is not the solution at all. It's trying to impose something, and then of course, the pharmaceuticals. It will, you know, all of the, well, that's something that's well, that gets too depressing, doesn't it? So people have been talking about peace and harmony among people. Can't we just all get along stuff? Forever on this planet. It didn't just start yesterday with, you know, today's youth didn't just say, hey, you know what, maybe we should have peace on the planet. It's always been that way. Always. And have not got it at all. And the idea is that we just have a right administration on the planet that has the right economic model for the planet and the right distribution of food on the planet, that we'll have peace on the planet is the most absurd thing possible. And I know there's like people saying that the spiritual masters are behind this and that they have a plan to make sure that everybody's fed properly and right medical care for everybody, and this is going to produce a utopia on the planet and that's salvation. That is the most nonsense. That is utter egoic nonsense. Because if you have physical sensory perception as your primary identity, establishing primary identity, you are going to be engrossed in judgment, maybe subtly, but severely, and it'll get worse and worse and worse. And that will engender conflict. Absolutely, you'll engender projection for the feeling of failure, for the feeling of emptiness, projection out on others, and attempt to manipulate and control others. Nightmare continues. Nightmare continues. Only the vision of oneness frees us from projection. That's it. Where is that being taught in the world? Where are the spiritual masters teaching that? Well, I know one that's teaching that, which is Jesus Christ for sure. And certainly in his teachings 2,000 years ago, and then in A Course in Miracles, absolutely is teaching that. And there are other bona fide spiritual masters who are teaching that, but the vast majority of so-called spiritual masters and all this kind of stuff is teaching this utopian socialism of, you know, equal distribution as being the answer is just madness. It's putting the cart before the horse. There isn't any reason why truth can't be taught in this world. But the habits of projection are so extreme. Now, young people born in this world, they had previous lives. And I've seen the lives, like the people that are living in this world right now, soaking up all this mass media, okay? My God, when they're reborn the next time, they're going to be hell on wheels in terms of how do you get through to them and try to enlighten them about this, the overall dynamic of projection. I mean, they're going to be so resistant. It's going to be incredible. They're going to find themselves on some, you know, some world, fourth dimensional, third dimensional world, where they're just, you know, extremely, extremely resistant to this. I wouldn't want to be someone trying to help them out. So that's it's like a firewall. They're building like the whole world's building this firewall against truth, really. All the while they're saying, oh yeah, we're headed towards an enlightenment, ascended world, and they're building a firewall to insulate them from truth. All the while spouting these, you know, these various teachings, etc., that they think are salvational, and they're not. Perception is the problem. Perception is really projection. And you have to be able to see this, you have to be able to recognize this, somehow gradually get this sense that yeah, that is true. It's a projection that the fault does not hear, it's there. my sense of lack is not from me, it's from you. You know, it's and that's actually built perception. Perception is we have to heal our perception. We're so used to perception, we're afraid to set it down. Perception is a horrible thing. Jesus said that the sight of form is the most extreme blindness. That's what Jesus said in the Course in Miracles, that perceiving form is extreme blindness. Extreme blindness. Perceiving form is extreme blindness. Perception is extreme blindness, actually, what we call perception of form. So perception needs to be healed. The continuity problem centers on perception. We're afraid to set perception down because it's really projection. We're totally accustomed to it. So instead of setting it down for knowledge, direct knowledge of reality, we have a perception of one shared identity. That's still perception. It's still perception. So that resolves the continuity problem. It's very simple, very simple. But we need our perception healed for sure. Perception is terrible problem. And as we, when we find ourselves with, identifying with human perception, human consciousness, human perception, we are sinking into a black hole of judgment, of false judgment, and insidiousness. It's insidious. The perception is insidious. You know, we don't realize how judgmental we are when we're perceiving. It's inevitable, totally inevitable. Which is why we should say, look, I have a severe continuity problem, and admit you do, because you've been perceiving. Period. You've been perceiving. You've been identifying with human perception. And that automatically brings about a severe, severe continuity issue. Not to mention we've been identifying with perception for so long in so many different forms, actually. And the human form is not the only form that perceives, right? Animal forms, plant forms actually have a mode of perception. All of this stuff, perception, all based on projection, all of it causing a severe forgetfulness of reality, a severe judgmentalness, a severe delusion, a blindness to God, a blindness to everywhereness, a blindness to everywhereness as being the ground of being, a blindness to the fact that all things occupy spaciousness, right? They don't block it out, they occupy it. They're dwelling in it. Everything's already dwelling in it. So, we have a severe continuity problem. We need our perception healed. And that's the only issue there is. There is no other issue. So the world is off on this crazy, 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 crazy jump into the abyss. We don't want to jump into the abyss. We want to jump into the vision of oneness. Or rather, we want to gently ease into it through our right spiritual practice, which is easy. It's not difficult. It seems a little challenging, but we're up to the challenge. So it's not that difficult. We're up to the challenge. So, what dispensation is there for those who are up for the challenge, right spiritual practice? They accept the fact that they have a continuity problem, mea culpa, I have, you know, the traditional, I have sinned, I have missed the mark, I have forgotten reality, I can't remember reality, I've fallen into this insidious judgmental state of perception based on this mistake of projection, and I want to remember reality. God, how can you please help me remember reality? What dispensation is there for those who are like that? Well, we're going to find out. Probably very soon. Very soon indeed. So, with that in mind, without a preconceived notion of just continuing to say, okay, if we need to step out of the way, let's step out of the way. How can we keep focusing on what we need to focus on? Is it possible to do it here in this world? Or is there some relocation or what? What's the deal? What's the situation? But keep on our right spiritual practice. Keep our humility. Keep realizing I have a severe continuity problem. I've fallen into this terrible judgmental condition through perception. I need healed perception. I have the spiritual techniques that enable me to accept the vision of oneness. I understand the vision of oneness. It's not difficult to understand. Simply the vision of no distance. Location makes no difference. Everything is equally near and dear. One shared identity. Just one shared identity. One equal identity. Perceptually seen, you know, it's like amazing. It's there for us for sure. It's there for us, and we just have to continue on a little bit more with our right spiritual exercises, our right spiritual practices, our right clarifications, and it will dawn upon us for sure. Okay, all right, very great. We'll see what happens next. I don't know, but stay tuned. That's it.